Welcome to the More Demand Podcast, where we help you generate more demand for your products and services. Every episode, we give you tips, tricks, and tutorials on how to get the best out of your digital marketing. Less frustration, more demand. Here's your host, Lawrence Howlett, with this week's freshest tips.
Hello and welcome to the More Demand Podcast, episode number 24, with my guest this week, Doug Kessler from Velocity Partners. Doug's company helps B2B companies develop compelling stories that resonate with their audience by being insanely honest, trustworthy, and speaking with their own individual voice. Today, we're going to talk about what's changed in content marketing, why you need to step out from behind the corporate curtain and embrace the new era of business-to-business content marketing. So without further ado, let's welcome Doug onto the show. Hi, Doug. Thanks so much for joining me on the More Demand podcast today.
Happy to be here. Thanks, Lawrence.
Yeah, no problem. So we're going to talk today about persuasive content and how that can be used to help, you know, generate some good high quality leads, get some traction to our blog, because a lot of people out there as well have just got a blog and they're you know, pumping out content maybe weekly and they're not getting much, action taken from those blog posts. So we really want to have a look into why that's happening, if they are creating the right type of content, you know, if it's the wrong type of content, what does the sort of new content look like, and how can they use content marketing to really drive some good high quality leads in there. So Doug, just give us a bit of background information on your sort of angle on B2B content, where you've got to in this point of your career, and a little bit of background info on what makes Doug an expert in B2B content.
Well, I'm not sure I would claim it, but I've been in it a long time. So I started my career in traditional advertising. So most of my career was in the old school B2B and even Madison Avenue type marketing. Started Velocity with partner Stan Woods back in 2009, and it was really a content marketing B2B agency then. We were pretty early into the content marketing thing, so we were evangelizing it early, 2008, 2009, and writing about it, and realized that we had to do content marketing if we wanted to talk about content marketing.
Absolutely.
So we started a program for Velocity itself, doing pieces, doing blogging, finding out what worked, you know, doing shitty stuff, doing bad slide shares, and little by little groping our way towards what worked for us. And that includes some, you know, slide shares that got a lot of views and some ebooks that did really well and some more hardworking content. So we practice what we preach. We also do it for a lot of clients, B2B tech clients. So, you know, companies like Xerox and Sprint and, you know, Informatica and all sorts of tech clients. And content marketing is the heart of what we do. So we're practitioners as well as, pontificators.
Yeah. Oh, perfect. So some real sort of on the ground experience to share with us today. I mean, if you were to sort of take an overview of content marketing today, what do you think has changed recently in this B2B space in terms of, you know, changing the way that content is perceived and consumed?
Yeah, I mean, so much has changed in a pretty short time. So I guess, you know, the broad brush thing is that content marketing is definitely gone mainstream in B2B marketing. It's kind of, it's what works. And just about everyone has discovered it. So back, you know, even a few years ago, we were trying to convince people to try this. And now people are coming to us for it. We don't have to convince many. Sometimes the people who are into it are bumping into their bosses who got to be CMOs or whatever in the old world and need a little convincing. But more and more, it's really gone mainstream and no one really needs convincing. Of course, that creates the problem of doing content marketing a few years ago conferred advantage, right? I mean, just because you were doing it, you were helping your prospects by sharing your expertise and you were the only one in your market doing it, that was a big advantage. Today, it doesn't confer advantage anymore. It still confers lots of benefits, but everyone's doing it. So in itself, content marketing doesn't confer advantage. You've got to do it better than the other guys now. That's the new game is doing it better, not just doing it. And we warned about this way back at, in a slideshow called Crap, Why the Biggest Threat to Content Marketing is Content Marketing. And that's what we were warning, really, was saying, hey, guys, when everyone's doing this, you're going to have to raise your game. You're going to have to create a great content brand and work at it as hard as you do your main brand.
Yeah, and I think, you know, a lot of people, you know, especially in the more demand listeners, they've got a blog. They've tried, you know, blogging those 300 word articles, and not many people get, you know, comments or traction about, you know, with their, even if they've created some guides or maybe some lists or, you know, some mini ebooks. So could you share, you mentioned that you had a successful slideshare presentation and a successful ebook. What do you think made those stand out from other ones that were, you know, possibly a failure?
That's a really great question. And, you know, one we are constantly asking ourselves for ourselves and for our clients. We've had two that really went home run on us, over a million views. So Crap is the slideshow that did, I think it's over 2 million now.
Wow.
And there's another one called The Search for Meaning in B2B, which is a much more personal piece. And that's about 1.5 million. And for us, those are big, big numbers. And they're very different. What's interesting, the Crap one, I think it was a timely issue that captured something that everyone was thinking and feeling and worrying about, but hadn't yet been said and hadn't been told to death. Because a lot of times people will just grab a hot issue or an issue, but it's been really said forever. This one was just at the right time when a lot of different content marketers were worrying about this problem of what happens when everyone does it. And most of the people who responded to us weren't saying, oh, I never thought of that. They were saying, that's exactly what I've been thinking. So that was a piece that crystallized something that was in the air. So I would say the timeliness of that issue and the fact that it was a fairly new discussion at the time. There have been many, many since on similar topics. You know, Mark Schaefer did Content Shock as a similar idea, and there's been plenty of others talking about, is this the end of it? But that was fairly early, and it was crystallizing something. So timeliness. The other one, The Search for Meaning in B2B, was much more of a personal piece of, you know, my friends are in glamorous careers. My friends are in important careers like, you know, Amnesty International or incredible causes. Why am I still in this B2B marketing thing? And it was in answering that question, where do I find meaning? Because I've always known I've loved this stuff. Where's the meaning? And I did the piece and I sat on it for a year because I thought this is really too personal. It's just about me and my worries and vulnerabilities and all that. But when I shared it, it really got a great response, and that was different than Crap. That was much more of a personal thing, and I think there's something to opening up and sharing some vulnerabilities and sharing just truth and honesty and something that actually really does mean something to you on a deep level. That was maybe what resonated with that one. So those are two different answers to that question. You know, each of them, I think, touched a nerve and resonated with audiences for different reasons, but that's what you're looking for, that resonance.
So that you mentioned, you know, you spoke out as an individual. You know, how does that sit with, you know, sort of corporate world of, you know, we've got to, you know, give the corporate voice rather than, you know, you gave an individual voice there that, you know, maybe is a little bit different from the classic, you know, this is what corporate says, or this is what, you know, our company should be saying. You know, how does that sit as an individual instead of on the company side?
Yeah, that's a really good question too. And I think one of the reasons I went ahead and published that one was watching other people do it well. So Rand Fishkin at Moz he's been very, very open about his own personal journey alongside Moz's journey. And the HubSpot people are good at that too, sharing their culture documents and things like that. And I started thinking, this is something going on here. And I think it's one example of, or one instance of, the old B2B voice dying. It's the death of the old B2B voice and the birth of a new B2B voice. And it's a very real thing. So I think what happened was that what it was to be a B2B brand, what it was to be a company selling to other companies, has changed. It used to be about we need to show authority and size and that we're venerable and trustworthy and all of that. That's what the brand was built on. And so the voice kind of came from that. It was this stodgy corporate voice. Now, a brand means a different thing. A B2B brand is different, and part of what happened is, you know, social media happened, blogging happened, people were putting their names on their work, bylines, and they were chatting out there in social channels, and that voice just didn't work. People, you can't keep that voice up in those new channels, and people started talking like human beings, and it felt better, and it starts to reflect the new B2B voice and the new B2B brand, which is built not on these authority and size things, but really built on authenticity and transparency and honesty and openness. That's a great B2B brand today. And so the voice springs from that, which is a human, open, honest, simple, direct voice. And for me, that's the voice that businesses should be striving for now, not hiding behind a logo or hiding behind a facade of some kind of venerable institution. But going ahead, getting out from behind that and talking like people to other people, I think that's a hugely important part of the new B2B.
Yeah, I think you mentioned Rand Fishkin there. I was speaking to him on just a couple of podcasts ago, episode 21 off the top of my head.
I heard it was great.
Oh, thank you. And he said, you know, it's so important just to connect with people properly. You know, go out for a coffee or go out for a beer, understand, exactly their challenges and how you can, help them, and then use your own voice. And I was surprised how open RAM was about, you know, for example, paying $3,000 to every employee to further their travel, aspirations. And it's, you know, that's or education. So it was quite incredible to just, you know, sort of learn about that new B2B or new voice coming out. And people buy from people, definitely. You know, there's the whole then piece about, becoming an influencer, someone to look up to and aspirational. And I suppose that allows you to have that voice alongside the corporate as well.
Absolutely. And I mean, what he says about meet your audience, I think is so important, because there's a lot of work on personas in B2B and trying to capture the essence of your target audience on a piece of paper somewhere or something richer. But, and I like them. I mean, you know, they're important to you. You have to have these. But I've noticed more and more B2B teams do the personas in a quick, cursory way, get them down and almost forget them. And they're an excuse for not getting out and meeting your target audience. And we're big advocates of sitting down with your target audience and spending as much time as you can. For our client work, we pretty much, it has to be part of our process, is to talk to customers, to actually hear their voice, hear them talk about their problems and their challenges and their worldview and just the language they use. And for me, that kind of, it feeds an empathy, and that makes for much, much better content, much better writing, because you're writing to a focused individual who you've spoken with. It's almost more like a letter to them, not a broadcast piece.
Yeah, so let's just explore that empathy, a bit more. How do you get that across in your writing? You know, how is that just comes from a pure understanding of the person that you're trying to talk to, or is there particular a style of writing, certain words that you can use, or a certain framework that gets that sort of empathy across?
You know, I don't think empathy in itself is a style issue. I think there are stylistic things you can do to help people relax and not feel like they're being marketed to, which lets you get that empathy message across. I think what you said before about it coming from understanding is the thing. So to get your empathy into your writing first, you really, really need to have that empathy. You have to feel it. You have to be motivated by the thing that motivates your target audience. Say, I want them to know this thing. I really want them to. So I do a lot of talks and conferences and stuff. And the ones where I feel best on stage or afterwards are when I've went into it with that motivation of, I get this audience, I know them, and I want them to try the technique that I'm pushing here. I want them to try this because I know it'll work. And when I've got that in my heart, I feel like it's a way better talk. The content's better, everything about it is better. And I feel that that translates into content too, is this coming from a place of understanding your audience and wanting the best for them, wanting the right things for them, and getting that in. You know, style, then you want a style that doesn't alienate, that doesn't keep people away from that throbbing message in the middle, you know, but style itself is not gonna simulate empathy.
Yeah, sure. It's got to come from the heart. And that's, you know, going back to you know, becoming an individual, not being afraid of, you know, getting that message across, you know, as you are being completely, you know, honest with yourself and with the people that you're trying to market to and you know, attract into your business and hopefully convert as a lead. So I think, you know, that honesty piece as well. Is there, you know, a way to, you know, sort of explore that a little bit more and get honesty across in terms of, you know, because some people might just have, you know, they might be a one-man band, for example, a one-person band, should I say, and they want to appear a little bit bigger than they are, but, you know, they can't then be completely honest with them, with the content on the website as they want to appear that little bit bigger. Is there, you know, a trade-off? Should they just be completely honest in their content, or, you know, should they, you know, show a little bit of you know, larger scale?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question. I mean, I'm a big believer in punching above your weight. I think there's nothing wrong with that, and I think you can do it without being deceptive at all. You know, you don't have to flaunt the fact that you've got a small team. If that team size of being a one-man band or a small team is actually limiting your ability to deliver success for your customers, you've got a bigger problem than a marketing problem. You've got a, you know, a yeah, proper business problem. But if it isn't, then you might want to ask yourself, well, do I need to hide that? Well, you know, isn't it okay? Because it's not stopping me from helping my clients or customers. So I'm a big believer. We've been evangelizing something called insane honesty, which is the opposite of marketing 101, the opposite of what they teach in marketing, which is only push your best foot forward all the time. And what insane honesty is taking your biggest weaknesses and not just admitting to them and being honest that way, but pushing them right to the front and showcasing them and leading with them. And we've got some great examples of it over history in marketing and current ones where people said, all right, we're just going to take that supposed weakness and make it a hero here. And we're going to actually be insanely honest. And it's an incredibly powerful technique. I'm surprised it isn't done more, actually.
Yeah, so explain a little bit more about this. In say, I'm intrigued to know about this because showing a weakness is you know, for me, that's a harder conversation. You know, to be honest about that is harder. You know, you have to to really push yourself to be able to do that.
Absolutely, it's counterintuitive. It's hard to do, but it's a terrific thing. So here's an example. Volkswagen inventing the Beetle, wanting to bring that to market at a time when cars were these huge things with fins. They were status symbols. They were expensive, big gas guzzlers. And you've got this weird looking thing. Now, what they could have done is ignore the aesthetics. The elephant in the room is this is an ugly car. In a world of big fin cars, this thing is weird looking. Ignore that. Talk all about how cheap it was, how its fuel efficiency was amazing. Had plenty of good things to talk about. But instead, it took ugly and it featured ugly. It had a headline and an ad called Ugly, this great campaign from Doyle Dane Burnback back in the 60s. And they just took ugliness and they owned it. They just pushed it right out front. Huge success. Just so surprising to that audience at the time. So charming, so funny. And I think what they realized and what people who have done this technique since have realized is that they were only alienating people who would not be likely to buy this car anyway. Their ideal prospects, the ones that didn't really want status, didn't want what the Detroit was offering at the time, those are ideal prospects. They don't mind. They like the quirky look of this Beetle. They like the humor of your approach. So what insane honesty often does is what it makes you do is admit to yourself, who isn't going to buy? Can we freely alienate those people? It's not going to hurt us and it may even help us. And then who's our ideal prospect? If they care about the weakness we're putting forward, like if it really is something that our ideal prospects would not like, well, that's something you have to fix. That's not something you're going to brag about. But if it's something that doesn't bother your ideal prospects at all and signals to them that you're being incredibly honest and open, then it's a wonderful thing to do. And there are lots and lots of examples. You know, Avis saying they were number two against Hertz at a time when you just never, ever admitted you were number two in market share. And they realized their ideal prospect and didn't care about that. They wanted to see an honest company that was going to try really hard and work for them. Lots and lots of great examples of companies that took the brave move and shared something that was a negative about their brand and really not just shared it, made it the hero.
Yeah, and I think that instantly builds trust. And, you know, trust is so important. You know, the you know, people will buy from people that they trust without a doubt. And if you can build that, you know, with your prospects, then you're on to a winner. You know, even if they don't buy from you, they are more likely to recommend you. And, you know, the word of mouth then grows. And I think that trust element, you know, is really, really important. So in terms of then getting that across in a web format, in, you know, what sort of things could we be doing in terms of, you know, content writing, or is that you know, going to come across better in sort of bigger marketing pieces, or is it about creating little you know, headline snippets that do that, and how would you build that into a campaign?
So the trust element.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think trust has to be everywhere. It has to be, you know, you're right that it's the number one thing. It's hugely important. And so you think, well, if it's that important, shouldn't we be actively managing these signals? And it should be everywhere, which is honesty everywhere, self-effacing humor, you know, being just transparent in everything you do. But in the bigger ways of, you know, actually embracing your downside and doing the insane honesty route, that's kind of a big, bold play for big content. But, you know, it can be in any piece of content. For one of our clients, we did a pros and cons of their solution. This is a bottom of the funnel piece. This is people are ready to buy. And we're doing pros and cons. And in the cons, we're saying, this may not be for you if X is true, Y is true. You may worry about this. If that's a big, big worry, don't do that. You know, a big list of why you might not want to buy this thing. And it just has, to me, a magical effect on the reader. It's saying a couple things happen. One, I can trust everything positive this company says. So all of those pros on the pros list, they're true, because if they weren't true, they wouldn't have told us that, you know. And that's a main thing. And the other is just, here's a person who I can believe, you know, that they're being honest and open with me. And the things that they're saying, again, if they really are important to me, and that this con is something that would chase me away, I admire a company who's willing to do that, because what it tells me is they care about my success as a customer more than their short-term revenue goals. They would rather alienate me than have me be unhappy with the product. That's a fantastic signal to send. You know, that plus that I can trust the positives, that's an amazing combination of messages and signals that you're sending, and it's very hard to send those any other way. So for me, I would like to go out of my way to look for opportunities to be that to give that insane honesty a try.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's really interesting. You know, you did the pros and the cons, you know, where it's not the right fit for you, and that that only, you know, has a knock-on effect in trust, but also you're then going to reduce things like your support time of answering questions post-sale. You're going to make sure that the right people are buying your products as well, so that, you know, you don't have those difficult client conversations later on down the line as well, I think.
Absolutely. And for some businesses, that's that match of the buyer and seller, that it's a good match, is so critical. I mean, for us as an agency, it's a relationship business. We're desperate that that match is correct before we start. And so for us, we use our marketing as a filter as much as a magnet. It's, if you don't like the us you're seeing here, you're not going to like working with us either. We're not going to like working with you. We're not going to have the same definition of what great marketing is, you know. But if you do, what a great place to start. So part of it is saying, look, very few companies need everybody in the world as their customer. So you might as well admit that you're not for everyone, and go ahead and tell people who you're not for.
Yeah, I think that's some great advice. So to bring it back to you know, writing some persuasive content and getting that content onto our, you know, onto our blog or into our newsfeed, or, you know, out as an email broadcast. Where do you start with that journey in terms of, we understand now who we want to read our content. You know, we've got, you know, these buyer personas. We've then talked to our you know, existing customer base and talk to our ideal clients. How do you then start finding out what content they need and want?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the content they need and want, it comes partly from that empathy and understanding, partly from, you know, the answering every question that people have ever asked you side of things, which I know Joe Polizzi mentioned in his talk with you, and I know Marcus Sheridan's a big evangelist of that, and he's, you know, he's right, you know, answer people's questions. But some of it is, you know, I put persuasion a little bit down the list not that I don't want to persuade. Ultimately, we do. But if it's my prime motivation sometimes, I think it triggers the marketing defense barriers that people have. If they feel like someone's trying to persuade them, marketing to them, selling to them, we all have these barriers that go up and say, okay, I'm going to take what they say with this in mind, the context that they've got an agenda here and I need to be careful. And actually, better content, better writing, better communication gets people to relax those defenses, doesn't overly try to persuade, tries to help them, tries to, it can be just intrigue and interest and entertain them, tries to surprise a little bit. You know, don't do what marketers do. Do something else and see if that gets you in a better, more direct, more human conversation with somebody. So, you know, I like to think about resonating, content that resonates as opposed to persuades, that people will respond to and say, yeah, that's someone like me, and that someone who's interested in what I'm interested in, cares about what, you know, my challenges in my job. And, you know, that resonance, I think, comes first before you get the, you have to kind of earn the right to persuade someone. And you can earn that right. And once you've earned it, go for it, persuade away. But I do feel that a lot of marketing tries to persuade a bit too soon before it's served its audience really well.
Oh, that's a great quote. Earn the right to persuade. I really like that. And in fact, you know, you definitely, you know, do as you say you do. And on your, you know, content marketing resources on the Velocity Partners website, you know, we're not going to force you to fill out a form so that we can nurture you until ripe. You'll know when it's time. You know, that's a fantastic bit of you know, just a little snippet that goes to say, okay, I can take my own time with this resource. And if I'm interested, I know where the contact button is.
Exactly. And, you know, we decided to take the forms away for that reason. And that's not necessarily right for every company or all our clients. But we did kind of feel like, look, this is who we are out here. We want as many people to read it as possible. And if some of that resonates and you do want to step forward, we're here, you know. So it's worked for us to let people come forward in their own time and not feel like we need to snag their data and then hammer them.
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, with some products, you're going to have to do that. You know, for example, if you've got a cart close date, or, you know, you've got an informational product that's going to, you know, hit a certain deadline, you need loads of triggers and you've got that sales funnel, then, you know, that's not the right approach. But where you can, you know, just not, you know, try and drill it home or force feed them all the time with, you know, content, you know, just be there for when they're ready. You know, that's a great approach.
Yeah, and I think, as you say, it's, you know, some companies need to be more aggressive. We're a small agency. We know we don't need to be that aggressive. So, you know, there's a place for forms. There's a place for that hardworking, absolutely. But, you know, the confidence of not being able to – not having to grab everyone by the lapels and shake them every time you meet them, that is a confident thing to do. And we – if there's one thing we try with all our clients is to – make them help them market in a confident way, you know, that they're good at what they do, that they know it, and that they don't need to shake everyone's, you know, shake everyone upside down to get their lunch money just to get their business to be successful.
Yeah, and I think, you know, having that confidence also, you know, I'm trying to think of the opposite word and I can't now, but it doesn't stifle you in terms of what, you know, you can put on the blog. Because then if you're not thinking, oh, this blog post or this article has to, you know, bring in X leads or, you know, things like that, it's going to push you down a certain content route that might not be your best content and might not serve your audience, you know, in the best way. So having that ability just to say, you know, we're creating this content because we can, we know it's data driven, we know that it's going to help our audience, rather than just go, right, we need to persuade you to buy this, so we're going to create a top of the funnel article that sort of starts you down that route.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's so important. And for us, and, you know, fun is actually has a real role in all this. And if you're writing content for fun, you're going to be in a closer to a really good place. You know, it can't be purely for fun. It's not just that. But if you're not enjoying it, if it's all about should do this, should do that, it's unlikely to have that joy that is a magnetic aspect of great content.
Yeah, sure. So those sort of that great content comes from, you know, writing things like compelling stories. So how do you go about from an agency point of view, how do you go about abstracting that story from, you know, from one of your clients and getting that across then in their content?
Well, you know, part of it is, you know, looking for great stories that are in their world. So things they've inspired or done or something that actually has touched someone else's life or world or work. And there are many, many stories. Another thing is digging down into the why you do what you do. So we try to look for why does a client do this? So you can have something that seems quite boring on the surface, a procurement software client. And you think, well, what is their why? Why did they even start this company? And you talk to them and realize there's someone there who hates waste. I mean, for them, waste is this viscerally wrong thing. It's almost like an immoral thing to waste. In a world of scarce resources, wasting is immoral, you know. And there's something really energetic at the heart of that. There's something real. And that why do you do what you do, for us is a great source of content that resonates. It's getting into the heart of it, not just the head of it. So all B2B content, we're all good at convincing someone on the merits and, you know, the rational argument and, you know, trying to get someone to think something. But to get someone to feel something is an extra boost there that I think not enough B2B content is going for. And that comes from going down into the why you should care. Why is this important? Keep asking the whys till you get to something that feels real and important. And for me, a lot of great stories come from that.
Yeah, because I say you mentioned there, you know, you've got to feel, even in a B2B, you know, we think of, you know, in B2C stuff, yeah, we feel like, we like that particular shirt and we feel we'd look good in that, you know, that exists in B2B as well. And it's so important to try and get that across, that, you know, people will buy based on their emotions and feelings, not just, just from what their head thinks.
Absolutely. I mean, all the books on behavioral psychology that are out there now, and they're great, great books. I love Thinking Fast and Slow as a favorite. But they all show that the decision-making part of our brain is not the part of our brain where rational analysis happens at all. And there's so many studies about this showing that we make decisions with our gut, our heart, and the head then follows and rationalizes. You know, it chases behind and tries to make sense of what we've already decided. And, you know, I think that's a powerful thing to bring to the table when you're talking about B2B content. You know, how do we make something feel right at that lower level? And then you can worry about the convincing part.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, for example, you could, you know, play on the strings. You know, if someone's got a huge project to deliver, there's going to be stress there. So let's, you know, look at that emotion and how we could help reduce that stress level, maybe with our new project management tool or whatever, you know.
Absolutely. It is. And one of it is like, you know, what does great feel like? So often what does great look like is what a lot of people do. What does great feel like? You know, that's an interesting thing to explore. And it's a whole different thing. You know, for Salesforce, we did one where what does great customer service feel like? And it was one of the pieces was done all, it's a slideshare with just written on post-it notes, basically. And it's someone quitting their job. It's a customer service agent who is so frustrated that they can't help people who are calling that they quit. They just have had enough because they're not given any of the tools they need to or the power to help customers. And that's an emotional moment. It's this feeling of, wow, what it must feel like to be a disempowered, frustrated customer service agent versus what it would feel like to be an empowered one with all the tools and information you need. And that's all about emotion, but it took us to a whole different place than we would just go if all we were talking about was the ROI of Salesforce software for customer service.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that's you know, really impressive advice, and you know, thanks for sharing that case study. So for people to get started in this, what are some of the initial steps, just to wrap it up really as a takeaway for our audience to after listening to this, what would you like them to go and do and get started? What's the foundation for that?
Okay, I mean, the thing I would urge everybody to start with is to find their sweet spot in this content marketing landscape and universe and in their own market. Every company has a sweet spot, and it's where the, let's say, two overlapping circles, a Venn diagram. And one of the circles is what your audience cares most about. And the other circle is what you have an authority in, what you have the credibility in, and what you're able to speak about and what you bring to the table. Where those overlap is your sweet spot. And we found early in content marketing, people ran from what they cared about or what they did, like their products. They were always writing about that nobody cared about. They learned about content marketing. They ran into the other circle, past the sweet spot and into, oh, we'll write about what other people care about, what our audience cares about. But they forgot about that second part. Well, yeah, they do care about that, but they don't believe it from you. They don't want to know from you. You don't have anything special to say about it. So stay in your sweet spot, and all your best content will come from that, which is, you know, your audience cares deeply about this, but you really have a unique thing to say about it. You're bringing something to the table others don't bring. If you're in there, that sweet spot, I just think your winning content will definitely come from there, and you should keep your content as much as possible in or as close to that sweet spot as you possibly can.
Well, that's fantastic advice. Thank you so much for sharing that, Doug. And, and you know, I really appreciate you coming on the show today and sharing those ideas and case studies and how to get started, with your content. It's been fantastic talking to you. I really appreciate you coming on the More Demand podcast.
Thanks, Lawrence. Enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah, and we'll see you next Wednesday for another episode of the More Demand podcast. Thank you so much for listening.
Thanks for listening to the More Demand podcast. Make sure to hit that subscribe button on iTunes and get the latest episode direct to your device every Wednesday.